My name is Brian Hammer. I'm with Rice University's Houston Asian American Archive Project, and I'm here today with Mr. George Fujimoto in the offices of his company, Vibrant Vitality of Houston, located in Houston, Texas. Today's date is Thursday, March 8th, 2012. And may I repeat your name, your age, and your place of birth?
Okay. My name is George Fujimoto. I was born in California, a place called Colusa, California. That was in January 13, 1920.
Great.
And
how long did you live in Colusa?
We were in Colusa 18 months, and my parents moved to Colorado. And he bought a cherry orchard in Colorado, and he raised cherries for a couple of years. And then after he sold that, we moved to Longmont, Colorado. Then he started farming there for a few years, and I'm going to say approximately in 1920, from Longmont, we quit farming there and moved to Uvalde, Colorado, and farmed in Uvalde, Colorado. And farming in Uvalde, Colorado, we raised sugar beets, vegetables, and so on and so forth. And we marketed that with a truck, and a vegetable we had, we contract peas, which is English peas, to a canning company, and at harvest time we harvested that and took it to the factory for them to process it. We also raised sugar beet, and they had a sugar beet factory there called the Great Western Sugar Beet Company, and we hauled our sugar beets to the sugar factory. And the other produce was, we had different kind of produce, you know, vegetable produce, and we hauled our vegetables to different places. If it's cabbage, you go to cabbage. And
that's great. So what kind of, as a child, did you work in the farm, on the farm, or?
Yes, I did.
What kind of work did you do?
And we did all kind of labor work.
Okay.
And, of course, my time there, it was during the Depression, tough times. So my father wanted me to do a lot of work on the farm, so I didn't have too much chance to go to school. So I missed most of my school. In fact, I didn't get to really go to school much, because when I might have been about 10, 12 years old when I had to start leaving school and going back and working on the farm, helping that farm. So I didn't get to go to school. In fact, I didn't get to go to high school. I didn't graduate. So I went through to ninth grade. And that's when my father got hurt, got kicked by a horse, and got me to really work on the farm. So my dad said, well, George said, you're the oldest one of our family, and you need to help me. So instead of continuing school, I think you'll have to probably go quit school. Well, I was happy. I mean, I didn't like school because I couldn't keep up with the rest of the students, you know, going in 3 or 4 months out of the year like the rest of them.
Right.
I was happy I got out, but I sure wish that had continued. And after, you know, you don't think about that until it's too late.
Sure. Well, so you went to school, so you started school in kindergarten and then went for most of the, like, elementary school years. Did you go most of the time, or how?
Well, a lot of time I still had to do a lot of work at home.
Okay.
But I finally got to the ninth grade. And at that time, that's when I had to, you know, really quit.
Yeah.
And work on the farm.
Yeah. And how many siblings did you have growing up? Do you have a brother, or?
Oh, yes. I had three brothers and three sisters. There were seven of us in the family.
Yeah.
My parents had quite a few kids. Yep. Seven of us.
That's great. And you were the oldest.
I was the oldest.
How many years separated you?
Most of us are separated by 2 years apart.
Okay. Okay. So that was a busy family.
Yeah.
And did your mother work in the farm as well, or did she?
Yeah, she was a home, keeper, but she helped on the farm a lot. And so she had to do a lot of farm work.
Did you have any animals on your farm, or?
Oh, yes, we had, we also had cattle, we had hogs. And
wow.
Of course, we had horses, and that's what
we
had.
Besides horses, But you also had, did you have milk then, or did you have things like
that? We had milk cows, and we, my parents fed beef cattle for the market.
Okay.
So we had that, and also pigs went to market.
Wow. So did you have to get up really early in the morning and do all your work at 5 in the morning?
Or Well, we had to get up early in the morning and go take care of the animals before we got to eat breakfast. That's farm life, you know?
Right. And when you had breakfast, was it mostly your farm food or was it other things?
No, we raised most of our food, so... we did not have a trouble with food.
Yeah.
In fact, I think the only thing we had to buy was sugar, coffee and salt, and flour. The rest of the thing, or most of the thing, other than that, we had our own. We had our own meat because we had our to butcher, and we had beef, we had pork, chicken. So we didn't starve.
Sounds good. Pretty nice. Now, how did your family get into farming in the first place? Do you know?
Well, I think my dad probably just kind of learned it. Because I don't think he was a farmer in Japan. I'm not sure.
And were your parents born in the U.S. or in Japan?
No, they were born in Japan.
In Japan.
Yes, they immigrated to the United States back in... before the 1900, I guess, in 18-something.
Do you remember where they were from in Japan, or?
Well, I don't remember. I just heard that they were from Kumamoto, Japan.
And did they come to the U.S. together, or did they meet?
No. My dad was a stowaway. He left Japan when he was a little brat, about 11 years old. He got to the Gulf of Mexico, and he was forced off the boat, so I hear. So they had to swim in, and he swam in and to Mexico and got as far as to Guadalajara, I think that's what he said. And he was taken in by a Mexican family. They took him in, they fed him, and gave him some clothing, and said, well, you gotta work for us. You gotta do the housework, and take care of the housework, and the garden, and whatever we had here, and we will send you to school. So he was lucky that he got to go to school. He went to school for 2 years, or about 2.5 years, they sent him to school. And when the Mexican Revolution happened, that's when my dad said, he gotta go, I can't stay here. So that's when he left. And he come in the United States and come in through Juarez, I guess, and went into California.
Well, did he come alone, or how did you know how he made the trip?
Well, he come with a friend, another friend come with him. The two of them were still away. His friend stayed in Mexico, and Dad said he wasn't going to stay there, so he went to California. However, Dad's friend kept writing to him. He said, come on, back to Mexico. He said, I got into a trucking business, and I'll get you in with me. And Dad said, no, I'm not going. So that's why he stayed in California, and from California went to Colorado.
Wow. Very interesting. How about your mother? Do you know her? How she
My mother, her parents come over.
Okay.
And my brother, and her brother, two brothers, and mother, and her mother and father, they come together to the United States.
Hmm.
And from what I understand, they knew each other in Japan. I guess they were close together before. And so when they got here, they went to California too, and that's where they met again, and that's where they got married in California.
Mm-hmm. And do you remember what year they were married, or approximately?
I had it written here, but I don't know. I don't know. You say when the date and their marriage?
Sure.
Okay. She was born in May 20th, 1897, in Shimoyabe, Kumamoto, Japan.
Hmm.
And my father was born in March 2nd, 1890, the same state, Shimoyabe, Japan.
Hmm.
And they both passed away now.
Mm-hmm.
You want the time of day?
Sure.
Okay. My mother died on October 9th, 1973.
Mm-hmm.
My father died in January 15th, 1975.
Mm-hmm.
So my father lived a couple years older. Mm-hmm.
Where were they living when they were in their older years?
They got married in California, in that town that I said in,
mm-hmm.
Where did I say? I forgot. In California.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man, I don't have no one. Not smart enough.
That's okay. And did they ever move to Texas, or?
Yes, they did.
Oh.
After I come back from the service, I tried a farm in Colorado, but I knew all along that farming in Colorado is a tough place to farm,
mm-hmm.
because we had two elements. That's the thing that I always said in Colorado against it. One was the weather, the other the price.
Uh-huh.
Neither one of those we could, you know, we had no control of.
Right.
So I tried to farm a couple of years in Colorado, and I had a hard time. I couldn't make it, so
mm-hmm.
I said, I'm going to get out of here. So I took literature from different places, and finally I got a literature from Rio Grande Valley. You know where that is?
Yes.
McAllen?
Sure.
Origin? Okay.
Sure. To McAllen?
Yes.
Okay.
And there was an outfit down there by the name of Benton Corporation that was in there. Real estate business.
Mm.
So I got in touch with them, and we made a deal to come down there to look at the land.
Mm.
So at the time, my father says to me, he says, can I go with you? I said, well, yeah, if you want to go, you can go.
Mm.
You like to pioneer too. You went from California, you know, all the different places,
right.
All right. And if you want to go, we'll go see. So he come with me, and after we looked at it, I didn't look at it good enough, my father didn't look at it good enough, we were real anxious to get out of Colorado.
Uh-huh.
So I stuck quite a bit of money down there, and my dad says, well, I'm going to go with you if you don't mind. I said, I don't mind, but you can go with me, but we don't know how we're going to end up.
Mm.
Well, it wasn't bad, good, I mean, it was bad.
Mm-hmm.
We got here when we were going to run into a drought. And they had about 4 or 5 years of the drought.
Mm-hmm.
So we couldn't raise any crop.
Yeah.
And I had to get rid of my farm and citrus, give them back, and go back to work. And at the time, it was a drought. And we had our water to irrigate the farm. Everything was pumped from the Rio Grande up to a level where it would flow to the land. And, you know, but there's no water in the Rio.
Oh, my gosh.
So we had to get out. And my brother was with me, so I told my brother, I said, boy, I said, well, we're in trouble here. I don't know what we're going to do. But I said, we're going to have to go out and work or something. But in the meantime, I got from Harlingen, I got a newspaper that had an advertisement in the paper where there was a man by name of Outlaw, that was his name. Had a name advertising there that he had a farm in Alabama, and that he wanted a Japanese family to farm it for him. Well, I got the address, the farm, and had the paper, and I asked my brother, I said, Roy, we're not going to make it here. I said, we're going to do something else, but I said, you thinking you might want to take a chance and go down there and look it over? I said, I can't leave here. I'm too much in debt. I got to pay off the debts here. He said, yeah, I'll try it. So he went. And I said, you take Mom and Dad, too, because they might want to go, you know, they probably don't want to stay here. So he took them, kind of like a vacation, and went over there and spent a week. Never could find the man. So he said, heck, I got to come home. And he started to come home. And what he done is on his way home, he saw an ad on a, I guess it must have been on a roadside someplace, that this nursery wanted somebody to come and take care of that nursery. So my brother said, he stopped. And he talked with them, and they gave him a good, deal where he could stay there and work for a little and kind of work himself up and get into the company. So he was working for, you know, like nothing though. And he got to work about 2.5 years before he got that place in good shape. At that time, the lady said, we don't need you no more. So he didn't know what he was going to do. So he called me. Then, in the meantime, I met a fellow in Mission that had a friend here in Houston.
Mission, Texas?
Yes.
Okay.
So I called my brother back, and I said, Roy, I said, this friend of mine here in Mission got a friend in Houston that got the produce, Holly Produce, you probably heard of it. Okay. And he got a farm in the produce market, so he wanted somebody there, you know, kind of help the farm. So I asked Roy about that. He said, yeah, he said, I'll try it for a little bit and see what happens. So he farmed here in Houston for a couple of years, but farming's still not that good. So after 2 years or so, he was got in with a nursery, and he worked the nursery for a while. And after a nursery, he said, I've got to keep going and doing something else. So he got a job with the city of Houston. And the city of Houston, the job was he worked for the flood control. And so he stayed with them for about 25 years, I think. And of course, at that, when he got the job here, he left the nursery, and his company, the nursery, was a man that his niece, I guess, from Japan. And so that's where he met her, and after a while they got married, so he married her, and he'd been with her for, you know, for quite a few years. So he had raised three boys and one girl, and that's his family. And he just passed away about a couple years ago now.
Yeah. And so it's a very interesting story. So you, so your brother went off to Alabama, worked, and then came back to Houston, and you were in the Rio Grande Valley.
In the valley.
And how long were you there, and what was that like?
I stayed in the valley for 1952.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, 1970. Or 20 years, so.
Oh, okay.
It was around 1970.
Oh, okay.
So I done all kind of work over there. I was jack of all trades, master and I.
Yep.
I run a salvage yard, and I went to produce business, and bought and sold produce, and then all that stuff. And that wasn't too good a, you know, job for me because it wasn't steady.
Mm.
So I told my wife, I said, you know, I've been around a lot. I went to a lot of Texas, all over Texas and Mexico, and farming and so forth. And the area that I like best was Uvalde.
Mm.
So I told my wife, I said, when I get ready to retire, I'm going to move to Uvalde. I'm going to retire in Uvalde. Well, that was fine, but it didn't end up that way. In 1969, I had an urge, I'm going to go into the bowling business.
Oh.
So I checked around and located some equipment, some land and property. And I bought a bowling center, which was a bowling center, but it was all cleared out. It was only a building, but the building was still there. So I called the owner about that, and he said, yeah, it's for sale, it'll cost you money. I said, well, I expect that. I said, I only expect to get it for nothing. But I said, I'm going to ask you how much you want for it. And he told me, I said, you know, I can't give you cash. I'm going to have to make payments. It's all right. We could work it out if you want it. So I went back to Mission and I told my wife, I said, I think we're going to go ahead and make a move. I located a place in Uvalde. I'm going to get back in touch with him and tell him whether we're going to take it or not. So that's what I done. Now I went back and told Mary, and I went home and come back, and I called the man, and we made the deal. And before we made the deal, he says to me, he says, we got to know each other pretty good because I talked to him a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Call me George. He said, okay, and his name was God, I forgot what his name was. Anyway, when we were making the deal, he says to me, he says, are you going to run the bowling alley, or are you going to get somebody else? Are you just going to own the bowling alley and try to, you know, let somebody else run? I said, no, sir. I said, if I buy the bowling alley, you sell me the bowling alley, I'm the one that's going to be here and run it. He said, I like to hear that. He said, otherwise, I was going to tell you, I'm not going to sell it to you. Because if I sold it to you and you didn't run it yourself, you can't make it. I said, thanks for the information. I said, and I'm not going to let somebody else run it. I'm going to run it myself. Then he was telling me a story about if somebody else had the place there, he said, the money's not going to go in the cash register. I said, I figured that. So I knew in my mind that if I run get the bowling alley, I'm going to run it. And I run it for 36 years.
Wow.
Yeah. I had a long go of that.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's great.
So I had a lot of bowling in the business. I got that then.
How do you spell the place where it's located? The U Valley or?
U-V-A-L-D-E. U-V-A-L-D-E. U-V-A-L-D-E.
Oh, okay. Uvalde. Okay. Right.
And that's where I spent 36 years.
Huh.
And probably the last 10, 12 years, my daughter has got this place here now.
Mm-hmm.
She says, Dad, you got to come to Houston. There's no way that you could stay there. I'm like, yeah, I have to because I own the property and I don't haven't got it sold yet.
Mm.
But she says, you know what? She says, you know, you're getting old, she said. I said, I'm not old yet. She said, I can't take care of you if you live in Uvalde.
Mm.
You got to get up here.
Mm. How many years ago was that?
I moved here in 2006.
Okay.
So I've been here 7 years.
That's great. So very nice. So you've done many things as a, in your career, just of work. You, as a child, you worked on a farm, and then as an adult, you worked on a farm. You had your own farm. You've done other many other things.
So. Yes, I did. After I went broke on a farm, we went down there. That's when I had to do produce business. I had a salvage yard.
Uh-huh.
I run a salvage yard.
Mm-hmm.
I'd done everything I could think of.
So when you had the salvage yard, did you have, you had a, and the bowling alley? Of course, you also had employees. You know, you
well, I, in the city, in the salvage yard, I had one helper.
One. Okay.
But that was all because it wasn't too big. You know, I'm just starting.
Okay.
So I had to do most of the work myself.
Okay.
In the bowling, I had one help, one girl. Helped me and my wife run the snack bar.
Okay, so it was a family?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it was just a 12-lane house, so we had to run a family.
Okay.
So whenever I was doing that, also, you know, when things were kind of slow, I had to work outside. So I got me a job. I was a salesman. I sold fertilizer to the farmers in that area. To help me, you know, and get that going.
Sure.
That's what I had to do.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. So we skipped over some middle years there in terms of your, so you were in school through ninth grade and then you worked on the farm with your father and your rest of your family. And I'm wondering if we could just go back to, just talk a little bit more about the school time and how you, what that was like? Were you the only Japanese family in town, or?
Oh no, there was about six families, Japanese family in that community.
Okay.
Small place, and they were all farmers.
Okay.
So we formed there until I went to service. And,
okay.
And after I went to service and come back, when I was going to try again, and it was no good, so that's when I made
the move. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Right. So how did you come to be in the service? So we'll talk about that process.
Well, this goes back to 1940. In 1940, I guess you probably knew all young boys, the minute they had 21,
mm-hmm.
they had a draft. I mean, you know,
mm-hmm.
Registration.
Right.
We had to register. For the army,
mm.
So I was already registered for the army. So in 1942, I went in the service in March of
42. Mm.
Yeah.
So you were drafted, or you just
yeah? I mean, well, of course, you know, our name was called, so we just
okay.
went.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And initially, where did you go in the military? What was your
We went from Greeley, Colorado. That's where our draft board was. So we went over there, signed up, and,
mm-hmm.
and from there, they sent us to Denver, Colorado, or not Denver, Colorado Springs.
Okay.
Induction Center, called it.
Mm-hmm.
Then from there, we went to basic training in Camp Robinson, Arkansas.
Mm.
Took our basic there. And after our basic, we were sent to Fort Riley, Kansas.
Which place?
Fort Riley.
Fort Riley, okay.
That was, Fort Riley is Federal Prison.
Mm. Okay.
I don't know whether you knew that or not. Federal prison at the time, but I don't know where they put the prisoners. They were still around there, not where we were.
Mm-hmm.
Because we had that building. And I don't know where the other people, soldiers, come from. I was one from Fort Riley, not Fort Riley, from Camp Robinson, went to Fort Riley, and I think I was the only one, the Japanese, that went to Fort Riley.
Mm-hmm.
And lots of them, they come from different camps all over the United States,
mm-hmm.
to that camp.
Okay.
And the more I thought about it, that was a concentration camp or a prison camp, really.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was all Japanese boys.
Okay.
That took training at other areas. We got some from California, Washington, everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And
just enlisted servicemen.
Yes.
Okay.
They were all servicemen.
Okay.
And of course, our officers, you know, we had Anglo officers, you know, because they we were there.
Right.
And the only time that I thought we were really prisoners, and I believe that's right, because when Roosevelt made his round, he's coming around and look at that place, you know, they put guards all around that building. We were in the building.
You weren't allowed to go out to see the president or just...
I guess not. Okay. That's as near as I can remember.
Mm-hmm.
I know we was guarded.
Oh.
Yeah.
How many, do you remember, how many people do you think were there of your Japanese American?
In our unit at that time? It's pretty hard to say, but I imagine they might have been 500-600 people there.
Oh.
Yeah.
And were you ever together in a large group, or did they keep you separated in the smaller groups?
No, we were all in that group.
Okay.
But they had us do detail work, dirty work.
Okay.
I call it dirty work.
Right.
Because they had us, as a gardener, we had to garden, do the lawn, and mow the lawn, water the lawn, take care of the swimming pool,
Who used the swimming pool? Were you able to use the swimming pool?
We couldn't use it.
Who used the swimming pool?
The officers there.
Okay.
And so we had to cook for the officers. They had a lot of officers there. They was training some for a second Louis scene. We had to clean their house. I mean, it was pure detail. So whenever we got time, we finally did get a furlough every once in a while. We all by turn, you know, take a furlough, get leave.
Yeah.
So, in order for us to go, we had to find somebody to replace us.
Oh.
So, well, they would say, "Hey, Joe, or whatever your name is, I said, you want to work in where I was working?
Mm-hmm.
So you get extra money, $5 a month more." And $5 was a lot because we only got $21 when we were there.
For a month?
Yes.
Wow.
So they took it. And then after you come back, "Hey, you gonna come back here?" I said, "No, you keep that job. I'm not coming back. I'm not taking that job no more." I was through it. So we didn't do it no more.
So what happened when you didn't do it? What?
Well, we done something else. We had to go do KP and
all
other different kind of dirty work.
Okay. So let me just clarify. So it was everyone who was doing this type of work were Japanese American soldiers. And everyone, the supervisors, everyone else, they were white, Anglo.
Yes.
Okay. And how did they talk to you?
The Anglo officer?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Well, I guess they were all right. We didn't have much trouble with them.
Okay.
And we had to feed all the officers, you know, in the mess hall.
Right.
Doing the cooking and KP and so forth. And, of course, a lot of them went to the school that they had there, cooking and baking school. And I was going to do it. Nah, I don't like that because originally I was kind of a farmer, you know, an outside man, so that wasn't any good.
Right.
And then there come a time when I guess the war come on, and they were going to organize the Japanese army.
Mm-hmm.
So they asked a bunch of for volunteers to go to another camp. Man, all of us at that place, I'm going to say all of us, I think most of us that was in that place was gone.
They
volunteered and went. So they all kind of temporary non-commissioned officers, that's what we were when we got over there. And then they got volunteers from Hawaii, young boys from Hawaii, and got them to come over here, and we trained them to be in the army. That was the 442, that's what the 442 was made up of. And the 100th is, was National Guard from Hawaii. And they were brought in to Camp McCoy, Wisconsin. So that's where the 100th was. So that's where the 100th got their name, is where the 100th. And so it was 100th, was different from the 442, but they kind of got combined when they went to Italy and France and those places.
So just to go back one step, to back to Kansas. When you went to Kansas, what were you told was your mission? I mean, why were you all congregating in Kansas?
Nobody said anything. You know, we just thought that was our military camp that we were going to go to. We didn't know what it was until we got there. You know, when we got there, we was all piled up in there, in that barrack, that big barrack there they had. You know, beds in there, small, close together. And that's the only thing we knew until we got ready to go.
How is that different than your experience later in terms of facilities or quality of the space?
When we left there, we went to Camp Shelby. And at Camp Shelby, we had lots of, they were American, Caucasian officers. And we didn't have any trouble with them. They were good officers. They knew. And we got to talking with them after a while. And they said, you're not going to have no trouble with us. We know you guys. We knew you guys from way back. You know, not the soldiers, but Japanese people. They were, you know, all among the Japanese people from different places. And so they treat us good. We enjoyed them. And we took our training again, another training. And
training in what were you training for?
Basic training. We done go out there and put the gear on and go out and train for, under fire and so on and so forth.
So how long were you at Camp Shelby? What was that?
In Camp Shelby, I was not there too long. I was at Camp Shelby until we finished training, basic. Then we were doing work a little bit. And then it got to a point they needed soldiers to go. So we kind of backed up. We didn't know where we were going to go. They said, you're going to guard German prisoners. Okay, so we got ready and we left Camp Shelby. They picked up some German prisoners that they got in Africa. They brought them to the United States. And they brought them to Alabama. And in Alabama, they had peanut farms. And that's where the prisoners were going to work on the peanut farm. So the farmers plowed up the peanuts, kind of loosened them up in the ground, and the prisoners had to get a pitchfork and go shake them out and the dirt off of there and stack it on little stakes they put on the ground. And that's what we had to do. We had to guard those prisoners. and I didn't get to do it too much. I think a week and a half or so was my time there. And we was coming home from guard duty, and we got in an accident. Had a truck wreck. And, of course, I heard that it was a T road. And the T road, and the end of that was an old riverbed. They said it was a pretty deep riverbed. I don't know which one it was. And I didn't know where I was until I got in the hospital. And actually, my parents come to see me. They thought I was dead, I guess. So I thought maybe I was there guarding prisoners for a week, maybe two. I got to talk to a few of the prisoners, but they were all, not all, but a lot of them was, they could talk pretty good English. They said, what are you guys doing here? You guys are Japanese, ain't you? I said, well, we might have been, but we're American soldiers, American Army. And we got talking. They said, you guys are allies.
So what did you say in response?
No, we're American soldiers, and we're here to guard you guys. Well, that was it. I mean, they didn't do anything else. I mean, they could have got me, I guess, but they knew better, I guess.
Yeah, interesting. So they didn't. So then you're in this accident, and then you're in the hospital, and what happened? Was it, how were you injured? Was it?
Well, that's where I spent most of my life. I mean, at Georgia. This is in Georgia. I was in Georgia.
Oh, so Georgia.
Georgia.
Okay.
Where I was in the hospital there.
Okay.
And I kept thinking to myself, I spent a long time in the hospital there. I was in the full body cast for 12 months.
Oh.
I had this side leg, it was in a straight cast all the way down, and this side was cut off here.
At your knee? Just below your knee?
The rest of it was in the body. And, you know, at the hospital, the officers, they come by, a lot of them would talk to you. But this guy never talked to me, just said hi or something like that. And they'd easily, I would think, they ask you how I'm feeling and so on and so forth. But that never happened. The nurse is the only one that talked to him. The nurses were pretty good. But in my mind, I never said anything. I kept quiet, and I stood out as long as I could. And finally, I said, I need to get out of here, because that was too long there. And I told him a story that I had a sister in Chicago, and of course, my parents lived close to Denver, see? And I said, I have parents close to Denver, so I'd like to get transferred. I said, I've been in this darn thing too long.
Yeah.
So I finally got a transfer. I got my transfer. And after I got my transfer, and I got to Denver, Fitzsimmons, there's two officers, a colonel and a captain, making their rounds, you know. And they would say, good morning, they talk to you, how you feel. And I said, well, I guess all right. He looked at that chart, and the colonel says to him, look at this chart, would you? And I heard him talk, and he said, I can't understand why they kept this soldier in a cast this long, a whole year. And that's when I thought the captain over here in Georgia probably didn't like me. They was going to keep me in that thing forever. Because if I heard them say that, so I should have been out of the cat,
right,
instead of being in the cat.
Right.
But after I got to Denver, that's when they took the cast off, and I was exercising and so forth. And, and I spent, it took me a long time to get straightened out, because they sent me to Georgia and back to Denver and then to Georgia, I mean not to Georgia, to Colorado Springs and back and forth. And finally, at the third time, they sent me to Washington, and I got my discharge in Washington in 1945. We had one of our meetings here, and that was in Yeah, before I come here, so and that's when I met some people. Not some, I didn't meet very many, just one fellow there. In fact, it wasn't him, it was his father. He said his father was in that unit. And we got to talking about that. And he says, maybe my father might have known you. But I said, I didn't get to know anybody there. Because when the accident happened, I was gone to the hospital.
Yeah.
And nobody knew that I was there. None of these guys.
Okay.
So the boy that said that he kind of knew my name, I don't know which one he is there, and he said that I heard you was dead. That's what he told me. I said, well, I'm not dead, I'm alive. And I'd like to, one of these days, maybe get to Hawaii and visit with you again. But I never got that chance, so I don't know. So, you know, whenever you get in a bunch of soldiers like that, and you don't have too much time, you know, it's hard to get to know them.
Sure.
So, I didn't get to know them, and so they all said that we thought you were dead, and of course, you know, when they showed me in the hospital like that, well, they weren't there.
Oh, my goodness.
So... I didn't have too good a time in the Army anyway.
Oh, goodness. So what did you, what were you thinking at that time, like about your treatment?
What?
What were you thinking about your treatment and your...
Hospital treatment?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, my hospital treatment, I never thought too much of it. In bed, laying in bed, I couldn't think of too much. Then when I got to Denver, I had physical therapy, you know, treatment all the time.
Yeah.
And it was all right. The only thing I wanted to hurry up and get well and probably get out, because they said they wouldn't be able to keep me in there, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had braces and everything, but I'm okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So you were discharged. You were transferred. You transferred to Washington, D.C.? Or you were just discharged?
They sent me from Denver to Colorado Springs, and they got tired of me in Colorado Springs. I went there twice for physical therapy.
Yeah.
Then they sent me to Washington, D.C. I mean, state of Washington.
Oh, state
Tacoma,
of Washington. Tacoma. Oh, Tacoma. Okay.
Tacoma.
Okay.
And I thought, man, I'm going to get some more physical therapy.
Mm.
Well, I got a little bit of physical therapy, but that's where I got discharged.
I see,
Tacoma. Washington. Yeah.
Okay.
So I got another slow train ride from Tacoma, Washington to Colorado. Yeah.
And at that time, your family was still living on the farm?
Yes.
In Alt? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. And your younger brothers and sisters, they were, most of them were still in school, probably? Or?
Oh, they were all in school when I left.
Okay.
So as I left, a couple of years, my younger brother, Harley, he went to service. He got into MIS. He was in the military service.
Intelligence. Uh-huh.
And then a couple years after that, then my third brother went in. He was in the Korean War. He went to Korea. And then my youngest brother, he was the youngest one, so he had his job with what they call a TDY, temporary duty. It was after the war, so he kind of went over there to patrol the area and so forth.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So there was four of us, boys, all four of us went to service.
Do you mean in Japan he went to temporary, or where was he at temporary duty? Temporary duty where? Your brother, your third brother?
Well, they sent him to Japan.
To Japan?
To, you know, kind of patrol the place there.
Right.
And my other brother was in MIS, why? He served a lot of time in Japan interpreting there.
Okay.
And of course, the Korean, why he fought in the Korean War.
Yeah.
Of course, this is what my brother used to tell me, and all the time we talk about that. And of course, he was in at the time when Truman, you heard of Truman, President Truman?
Of course.
Well, President Truman, I don't think, was too good a president myself, because he was the man that fired General MacArthur.
Uh-huh.
Well, my brother fought under General MacArthur, and that was in Korea.
Mm-hmm.
And in Korea, the North and South Korea just divided by line.
Mm-hmm.
North Korea was a communist.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
And that's what they were fighting.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, we cross that line, 38th line, and get over there, and then over there, you got to pull them back.
Mm-hmm.
MacArthur get ordered to pull back. He said, I don't know how many times we've done that. And so when my brother knew about MacArthur getting fired, well, he wasn't too happy either. And so naturally, as time goes on, we heard, you probably heard too, the nuclear war, I mean, they were going to start in North Korea.
Yeah.
That's when my brother said, if it wasn't for Truman, if it was Douglas MacArthur, we'd have got rid of that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure that's what would happen. Because
mm-hmm.
he said, we're there, yeah. but they pulled us back.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Uh-huh. Interesting. Yeah. What did your family think, after your experience in the military, what did your family think about the military?
Well, they never thought anything about it. They told us when we left, I said, you guys got to be good. Hold your face up. You don't want to be a pigeon, I guess. So we're all right. My folks never had any objection to that or anything.
Okay.
In fact, my dad told me after I come home, he said, you know what, you boys are lucky that the United States won the war. Because if the United States didn't win the war, you guys went in to the United States Army, and they know that.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to really get you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're going to crucify you.
Mm-hmm.
So I told my dad, I said, well, I'm glad we won.
Right. So did you speak Japanese at home when you were growing up? Or?
Yes, sir. When I was a kid, I know I had to speak Japanese because my mother didn't speak it. English.
Okay.
My father had to learn
right.
English. And we started school, and after I started school and started learning English and got the English, Japanese got away from me.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel embarrassed about it, but can't help it. I mean, he just got away from me, and I didn't proceed.
Right.
My younger brother, the one that went to the MIS,
mm-hmm.
See, we had a Japanese school, but he was more studious than I was. In fact, all along, he was already able to go to all the other schools, see, so
okay. So
he kind of studied instead of fooling around like me. Because
okay.
I knew a little bit, I could say some of the things when I went in, but I said, I can't say it, I don't know what to say. Mm-hmm. Okay, get out of here, you don't belong here. So I didn't go to MIS.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
I stay as a foot soldier.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
Okay. So, military service. What, when you're in the military, when you're serving over those years in the hospital, etc., what were you hearing about Japan or the war? What would you hear
about? Oh, not too much, except the war was going on, and they said they were going back and forth, you know, fighting back and forth and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
But that's about all. The place where I was, I didn't hear anything right there in the hospital. You don't hear nothing there.
Okay.
That we don't hear.
Okay, okay.
And that's where I was most of the time, right there in the darn hospital there.
Right, right, right.
So I didn't know much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting to me. Yeah, okay. Then you were discharged in Tacoma, took a train, slow train back to Colorado.
Yes.
And then you were in Colorado for a while. And how long before you went to the Valley, or how did that?
I farmed in Colorado for 2 years.
Okay.
And I was going to try to make it there, but I couldn't make it. It was too hard. And,
mm-hmm.
and so that's when I decided I'm going to go someplace else.
Yeah.
And find a more tropical place. So that's when I located the Rio Grande Valley.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I made my mind up to go to the valley. And
mm-hmm.
So my father said he'd like to go. I said, come on, let's go. So mm-hmm. I took him too mm-hmm. and went.
So how do you feel? So you grew up mostly in Colorado on a farm with there are other Japanese families in the area plus other folks as well. And then you raised your family in Texas, in the valley, Uvalde. How do you feel that those childhoods may have been different between yours and your children's?
Well, I don't know. I guess maybe our kids, you might say, maybe they come up more Americanized than we did because we were still with our folks.
Uh-huh.
And of course, they spoke Japanese, and we spoke Japanese too at home, but we never talked too much about Japan or anything. I mean, we didn't. I don't know about other families.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But that's one thing that my uncle gave me heck for. When my father passed away here, my uncle Charlie, he was the youngest one of my uncles, I guess. That's my sister's brother.
Mm-hmm.
And he come over here and he says, I talked about my dad. He said, did you know that your dad was come from a samurai family in Japan? I said, no. So he gave me heck. He said, how come you didn't know?
Mm.
Said, that's because I didn't ask. And I guess I was the only one. I was the oldest one. And of course, you know, I left fairly early because when the war started, the things was changing.
Mm-hmm.
And my younger brothers, they were younger, so they were still at home for a mm-hmm. lot longer time than I was.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of got away from all that pretty quick.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And my kids, especially my daughter from here, she was the youngest one, so when she went to school in McAllen, and I guess when she went to high school, she said she really had trouble in high school, just harassing her, you know, about the Japanese and so
mm-hmm.
forth, and she said she was really getting tired of that, but she said she had my... that book, that come out of a book. I had a book, the 442.
Uh-huh.
I had a book there, you know, what we do in the Army and so
mm-hmm,
on.
Mm-hmm.
So she took that to school,
uh-huh.
probably 3 or 4 years there during high school. And she explained it, tried to explain it to them because, you know, they had called her name and so forth. And I guess maybe that's why when she got out of high school, she didn't want to go to school anymore. She never said why. But
mm-hmm.
I was already in Uvalde
mm-hmm.
getting ready for that
mm-hmm.
bowling center. I had to fix it up. So my daughter, had, at that time, she started college Pan Am in Edinburgh.
Oh.
But my daughter said she didn't want to go. And so my wife called me and said, I don't know, we got to send her to school. I said, she need to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
But she said she didn't want to go. She wanted to come to Uvalde and work at the bowling center with me.
Mm-hmm.
And I told Mom, I said, that's no business for her. She needs to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
But she said, what am I going to do? She's not going to stay here at home. We just send her there. Here then,
mm-hmm.
she wants to work with me.
Mm-hmm.
I'll get her to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I didn't have any luck getting to go to school because she helped me. And
mm-hmm.
I said, you go to school here. We had a college, you know, junior college there in Uvalde.
Mm-hmm.
So she said, well, I'll go to data processing school here.
Mm-hmm.
They had that.
Mm-hmm.
She started, but that's no good, she said. But she wanted to come to Houston. I had her older brother went to school here in the data processing here.
Okay.
But, you know, when you go to school, and, a trade school or whatever you call it, I call it trade school, they can guarantee you work and so on and so forth. You come to my school and I give you a job when you get out. But that's a lot of baloney. Because I told Donna, I said, that's not going to work that way, because whenever you're going to work for a job, they're going to say, okay, miss, how much, you know, schooling you got, and how much experience you got. You don't have it. You just got out of school. But anyway, she kind of worked around and she got the job, and she done real good. She got two or three jobs because she took this job and not good. She not never satisfied. Finally, she got Lone Star Gas Company. She liked that. I don't know how she learned all that, but she picked it up after she got out. Because when you get into a chemical like that, you had to have chemistry, I thought. But anyway, she didn't have that. But she went to work with this guy and worked for him about a year and a half. And then she decided, well, I guess she's going to go ahead and get into a company by herself. But another guy said he'd like go in a company with you. If you're going to go in a company, well, we could go in partners. She thought that was all right, so she got in with him, and they worked for a year or so, and it wasn't any good. So she called me. She said, "Dad, I'm going to have to quit this guy. I'm not going to work with him because I got to do all the work, and he wants the credit. He wants to be the boss." And she said, "I'm not going to let him do that." So she says, "Well, okay, how much money do you want to get going, get on your way?" And I guess she gave him $5,000. I don't know what he borrowed it or what, but she done that on her own because I couldn't help her then, you know. And she got rid of him, and then she got on her own with a coal chemical. So she was married to a guy by the name of Cole, but he wasn't any good. So she took his name. She didn't change the name because she said, if I just go by Fujimoto, maybe a lot of people won't recognize the name. So she says, I'm going to go Cole Fujimoto. And that's how she's going to start the business. Because I think there might be some politics in there. So that's the way she started. And she started and going to start. And the guys with a different oil company that knew Donna, you know, they're doing business. You're not going to last there. You can't get that job. He said, that's a men's job, men's business. So Donna said, okay, you watch. And she got into business by herself. But she worked hard at it.
That's great.
So she got a good business going.
Yes. I'm wondering, maybe she got that, a lot of that from you, I suspect, in all of your industriousness and your hard work.
I don't know. But anyway, she didn't want to go to school. when I found out she didn't want to school, I said, God, that's not that good for her to work here in a bowling alley, because it's too small a place anyway, you know, 12 lane house, that's not for her. But I guess if she did that, that's all she'd do. Why, I could have, you know, after so many years, I could have got out and let her run it. But then I didn't want to do that. I wanted to get her an education and do something else.
So, I mean, eventually you did sell the bowling center, is that right?
Yes. Okay. I got it sold in 2006.
Okay.
And that's when I come up here.
Okay.
That's when my daughter... I think that she already knew that I sold before I knew it myself. I just feel that way, you know. I don't think so, but then, boy, she called me right away. She said, okay, Dad, it's time to move. You better come up. Said, okay, she said, I'm going to take care of you guys, and the only way I take care of you is you move up here, so I can't take care of you down there. So she's been good to us here. Treated us good, and she said, he keeps saying, he said, well, you took care of me, so now I'm going to take care of you.
That's great.
So she's got a good business. I'm glad she has, or she couldn't take care of it.
Yeah. And then I wonder if you could tell me about the vibrant vitality.
Okay, let me show you that, and then tell you.
Okay, great.
Easier.
Okay. Okay.
Well, this is a machine called a vibe machine. It's a electrical vibration magnetic treatment. It energizes you, and it could relieve lots of pain. It takes care of lots of pains that people have. And as far as the machine is concerned, a lot of people think it's a new machine invented not too long ago. But the man in Greeley is making these machines now. But this machine itself is not new. The vibrant vitality, it's electrical generator. It was first invented by 4 medical doctors in California. And at the time, they have given patients treatment, and they claim that they cured cancer 100%. And I'm not going to say that it will cure cancer, because this is not what we're supposed to say. We could get, in trouble.
I understand. Yeah.
So I could say, whatever it does, we can help you and help you feel better. We could make you healthy. But it will make you healthy, I think, because by being treated with this machine, it detoxifies your system.
Okay.
By detoxifying your system, you got to get rid of your liquid. That's why you drink lots of water.
Yeah.
And whenever we get rid of our poison from our body, I think we will not be sick.
Right.
It takes care of all the cells in your body, and it purifies your cell, so your cells are clean. Myself, I've taken this now for about 5 years, 6 years, and I take it quite a bit. And I believe this is why I am as healthy as I am. And I haven't gotten sick not one bit in 6 years.
Wow.
And my daughter that has this business here, she gives the treatment with this vibe machine to all her employees.
Oh.
And she was when she took her treatment, it helped her problem. So she said, well, I believe in this machine now, and I'm going to give you, the girls, the treatment, and keep them healthy. If I keep them healthy, that's money to me. They won't get sick.
Right, right, right.
And so that's what she's doing. And so she takes the treatment also. And
very interesting.
You may want to know how I got it.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Yes.
I had problems myself. A few years ago, I had Bell's palsy.
Oh.
And Bell's palsy, I got rid of it right away. I went to the doctor and got it cured. Within a week, I got another palsy on my left-hand side, and I went to the hospital, Veterans Hospital in San Antonio. And they said, we got problems. It kind of scared me a little bit. And he says, we got to go through here, right here, with a probe. I said, what do you mean a probe? I said, I think you're talking about a needle. He said, that is exactly what it is, a needle. I said, well, I guess you'll have to do it. That's what you're going to do. So he done that. And when he done that, what he done, or the doctor, they went up through here and they cut a nerve. When they cut a nerve, that give me the worst headache I've ever had. Bad headache. Yeah. I mean, it's throbbing headache.
Oh, yeah.
And no matter what I'd done, it would not help. I took acupuncture treatment, I took massage treatment. They said do this and do that, but it wouldn't help. And then by coming here to Houston, I was going to go to Colorado. So I went to Colorado and I went to see this machine because that's not what I went for. We just went for a visit, but they make it in Greeley, Colorado. So I come back, and when I was coming back, I talked to this girl here that works with my daughter, and she's got a cousin that's an acupuncture doctor.
Okay.
So I've been getting treatment from him, or I was. And on my way back, I said, called him up. I said, I'm halfway between San Antonio and Houston, and I'd like to stop by and get a treatment if you have time, if you'll give me a treatment. He said, I will. You stop. Come on. So I stopped and got my treatment. After I got my treatment, he says, have you got a few minutes to spend? I said, yeah. He said, my brother bought this vibe machine. He just bought it on his way back. He said, I don't know where he heard about it or what he'd done, but he bought it, and he's got the machine here, and the machine will take care of a lot of ailments. It take care of pain. It really helped pain. I said, that's what I want. So I took the treatment with him. And, well, of course, you know, you just take your treatment, that's okay. I felt okay, and I said, his name was Gilbert. I said, Gilbert, I said, you know, since I'm starting this with you, I want to make a contract. I want to get 10 treatments. Because I am hurting, and I want something to cure the treatment. I don't want to take it one time and say it don't work, because that's not my way of doing things. I want either by me actually taking so many treatments, and then if it don't work, it don't work.
Right.
But I want to find out.
Right.
So I said, I got 100 miles to come, but then that's okay. I'll drive 100 miles. So I come from Uvalde to San Antonio, which is 100 miles, once a week.
Wow.
And I took my treatment once a week. And at my treatment, the sixth treatment, I remember it correctly. I was sitting over here taking my treatment just like this, and all of a sudden my pain had just gone just like that. I said, Gilbert, I said, I feel pretty good, no more pain. He said, that's what I want you to do. I mean, that's what the machine is, and that's what I heard. That's why I got it. So that's how I got to know about this machine. And a friend of mine in Uvalde, he says, my sister-in-law, it was his sister-in-law, got colon cancer. But she was operated on, and she's in real bad way. And I thought maybe I could buy this and help her, because he heard it cured cancer. So he bought it, and bought one, and he's going to take it to her. And she told him to get the damn thing out of here. That's what she said. I don't want it. I've had all kind of treatment I want to get, and I don't want to take no more treatment. I'm through. I'm through with all that.
Yeah.
So I said, well, okay. He says, I know it helped you. But anyhow, he bought two machines. We bought two at that time. And we had this one here, stayed at the bowling alley that I had. And I operated that in the bowling alley. And so he took his home to his home, and when I got ready to come over here, I just paid him off on this one, and he took his home to his house, and I brought this here. That's why I got this machine. But the man in Greeley is making this machine. So actually, as far as what this machine will do is not new. It's an old, over from back in the 20s.
That's amazing.
So I can give people treatment, and some people I could just tell them what it does. I had a patient come in that just had a stroke. And her daddy brought her in a wheelchair, and she was not able to speak. And after several treatments, I probably treated her for about 6 months, I think. But she took a lot of treatments. But you know, it cured her. I could say it cured her. I mean, I can tell you that. I can't tell the company or somebody else. But she could walk and she could talk after a stroke. And there's several other things. A lady that was losing her hair got a treatment. And after so many treatments, she got her hair back. Thyroid problem, cured that. And that $20 bill, when I first come here, there's a Linda, Medcap. She says, I read your article but, about and everything, and it says something about the testimonial. It says, George, I don't want my testimonial written up. Fine. You don't want, I don't put. But after she took her treatment, well, she come back one day and she said, George, I'm going to take a treatment with you, but I'm going to tell you something. Okay. She says, you know, now you could put write my name down in the testimonial. I said, fine, thank you, appreciate that. So after I finished, I said, okay, now Linda, tell me what you had. She said, I got liver disease. I didn't know what it was, and I still don't know. I thought it was cancer, but I don't think it's cancer. But she says, I had that, and I had problems, and I was going to a doctor. But I wanted to get health insurance. That's why I didn't want my name in the testimonial, because the doctor going to ask me questions and think about that, and he finds out about this, then I can't get insurance. Fine. I said, okay. So then she wrote the testimony to it for me.
That's great.
After her treatment got well.
Right.
And there are several other things. You'd be surprised. I mean, it's amazing what this machine will do. I got a call from this girl in Uvalde, the one I was telling you that got the other machine. She said, George, I got a surprise for you. I said, fine. Just tell me. I'd like to hear it. She says, I have a patient that brought in a dog that had a tumor, and we cured it. I says, isn't that a surprise to you? I said, no, that's not a surprise to me. More, she kind of yelled. She says, what do you mean it's not a surprise? I says, how you know? I says, when we first got this machine, I don't know whether you read the article or not, but I've got the testimonials in there where there's two people had pets, dogs, that had tumor, brought pets to them to get treatment. And those two people had a testimony in that thing that cured their dog from tumor. And so after that was through, and he says, man, he says, I don't know, I didn't know that. So that's why he said it was really a surprise to me that, you know, she got her. But he said, thanks anyway. I'm glad you told me that, because now I could say we can cure a dog with a tumor. And if people want to know, I could tell them it's in Uvalde and it's in Texas. But the one in Colorado, I can't say that. That's too far away. I mean, you know. So I said, I'll just tell them that. And then I said, by the way, I said, I'd like to know who it was that had the dog. So you know him. I said, what do you mean I know him? I said, I don't know him. He said, his name is Juan Martinez. Juan Martinez. You mean the guy that got that townhouse restaurant? That's right. I didn't know that guy had a dog. He's got it. He had the little dog, and it cured him. So this thing, you know, a migraine headache. People have migraine headache. Stop that. So
very interesting.
Different things that it will cure, and there's a lot of things that it will cure. and probably it's a lot of them that I don't know of. So when they come with, I don't know, I'm going to tell them I don't know.
Right.
We could help, try to help.
Right, right.
And that's what I do.
Hmm.
So I know for a fact I cured one lady with a stroke. And in fact, there was another lady that had a stroke. Her hand was like this. She couldn't straighten it out. Mm-hmm. She's had it about 6 years ago, she said earlier. And when I give her the treatment, why, she didn't have the disclaimer sign. So I said, Linda, I said, you know, you didn't sign the disclaimer on here, and I'd like to have you sign the disclaimer for me. So I give her that pad and hand it to her. Oh, my God. Said, oh, God, don't tell me I messed up something. And she says, looky. I could open my hand. She said, I couldn't do it for 5 years. And I could open my hand. He said, that's really a surprise.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know, there's a lot of things I could take care of.
Mm.
And I know I took care of a lady with thyroid problems. A lady losing her hair.
Yeah.
All that kind of stuff.
It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Wow. So it's electric current.
Yeah.
And okay.
You like to take a treatment?
No, thank you. Not today. Thank you, though.
Electric won't hurt you.
I know. Yeah. Just going back, I think it's been a long time, so I just wanted to just ask a couple more questions.
Okay.
And maybe thinking about your service in the military, your relationship with the 442. And then we recently, just less than a month ago, had that banquet and the medal, of course, the Congressional Gold Medal. And I'm wondering if you could just talk about what that means to you today.
Well, I don't know. I think really what I can't say what it meant to me.
Mm-hmm.
It... as far as the medal concerned, I think it was a pretty good thing because that involves lots of things.
Mm-hmm.
It involves a lot of our lives, and it probably goes to show you where our parents, not ours, but I'm going to say our parents because a lot of the parents that was California people,
mm-hmm.
they were all interned, they were put in prison, you know.
Yes, yes.
And the boys that got the Medal of Honor got the, because they told about how they done, you know, went through all this too.
Mm-hmm.
So that was something I thought was pretty good because I think you need something straightened out.
Mm-hmm.
And better than that, what I thought is that. In fact, a lot of people don't know today, even the Japanese people don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But did you know that President Roosevelt already had in mind that he's going to intern all the Japanese mm-hmm. people before even the war?
No, I didn't know that.
I didn't know that until I read the Pacific Citizen, the last issue, in this December issue. And some people knew it. But I didn't know it.
Mm-hmm.
And I got talking with some other people, and they said they knew it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why he was going to do it, but that I heard that it was in the paper.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that's what it was.
Mm-hmm.
And the people that were in turn real bad, well, there were people like, you know, a Buddhist preacher or the one that preaching, going to school, going to do that kind of work,
mm-hmm.
they were the one that was really put in.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess they got out after a while, but then there's no reason for that, no cue for that.
Right.
And just like us, I mean, we were GIs, we were soldiers. We had put in that camp in Fort Riley, Kansas.
Right.
But why?
Right.
Mm-hmm. We didn't know.
What have you heard since about that Fort Riley? If people talk about that, and
no, we don't talk about it. We just, whenever it comes up like this, you know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
but sometimes some people mention it. The guys that, like a lot of the Caucasian people, they didn't know about the 442, they talk about it. And then if they ask me why, I mention it, but otherwise I don't mention it. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Mm-hmm. They didn't know.
Mm-hmm. How did you talk to your family about it when they were young? Or did?
No, in fact, I didn't, never even told them anything.
Didn't tell them anything?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why was that, do you think?
I don't know. Never thought about it.
Never thought about it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A lot of things that, to me, I don't think about it. And if somebody don't come out and ask me, why, I don't even think about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which is the best thing, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good way to move on. And Well, I think that's maybe enough for today. But I appreciate your time.
Thank you. Yeah,
and your insight and everything. It's really been a pleasure.
Went too much.
We could go on and on, I think. I would, you know, maybe we'll come back and see you again sometime. But it's been really a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Appreciate it.